Is holy. Nice to see you all. If it's your first time you've been here, we give you a warm welcome. If it's the second time, we give you an even bigger welcome. And if you've been here for a lot longer than that, then, well, you know what it's like. We love you anyway. So lovely to see you. And welcome to the kids. Where are you? Thank you. Over there. Lovely. And so, we've got some big kids at the back. 3 degrees over there in the back there. Wonderful. And one over there clapping away, fantastic, lovely. See, we're going to do some songs with you guys, if you want to join in later on. But first, we'll open our service with a good old song called I Stand Amazed in the Presence. If you're a Christian, then you'll know this song. It's like older than me. Yeah, a lot older than me. It's a great song. The words don't change. Please enter in with as much gusto as you can. Let's stand and sing.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned and clean. Oh, how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me.
it was in the garden. He prayed, not my will but thine. He had no tears for his own griefs, but sweat drops of blood for mine. Oh, how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. In pity, angels beheld him, came from the world of blind. To comfort him in his sorrows, he bore for my soul that night. Oh, how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. He took my sins and my sorrows, he made them his very own. He bore the burden to Calvary, and suffered and died alone. Oh, how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love. When with the ransomed in glory, his face I at last shall see, 'twill be my joy through the ages to sing of his love for me. Oh, how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. Amen. You may be seated. Okay, kids, it's your turn. How are you guys today? All good? Hello, okay, Liv. Hey, Bethany, coming up? No, okay. Oh, we've got a new one today. Oh, is he coming up? Ready, steady, go. So, we're going to sing. My God is so... sorry, I didn't hear that. I can't hear you. Oh, together. My God is so... Oh, louder than that, come on. My God is so big! You don't think he's that big? Okay, let's go. We haven't done this one for quite a while. It's the one that goes like that. Do you remember that one? You know that one, Caleb. Are you ready? you, Father, for our children, Lord. We ask you, bless them as they go to Sunday school. Bless their hearts and bless their minds and their spirits, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'm going to hand over to get some announcements through John. Thank you very much.
Hi, well, good morning, everyone. Nice to see some new faces here today. So you're very welcome. Thank you for being with us. Just a few things, a couple of things. We need to remember the Youth Weekend away up in the Compass Centre, which seems to be going fine, but that's why we're slightly mourning, because there's a team obviously away there. And the other thing, just to bring attention to, there's a membership class tomorrow called Membership Matters, and it's going to be online. So if you're interested in membership, then maybe you can come and speak to me about that after the service. Just an update as well on John Melville. He's had a couple procedures this last week, which seemingly went well, but he's now got complications. And the family just asked that we would pray for him just now, and he's got an infection that he's fighting too. So we might remember John. John gave a lot to this group of people here in the early days when we met in the lads club. So we'll remember him in prayer today too. So let's just commit these things. And also Cliff is our speaker today as we continue looking through 1 Peter. So let's just commit our time to the Lord. Father, we just come to you today, and we thank you for this opportunity, Lord, where God's space can interact with human space. And Lord, when you come, you change things, and we all need to be changed. Lord, we need to experience your Spirit and your renewal. We think we're in a battle all the time against the powers of the flesh, the world, and the devil. So Lord, help us today. May we be challenged. We pray for Cliff as he speaks to us. And Lord, we pray you'll speak into our hearts. We pray too for the children as they go to Sunday school. We commit them to you. Pray for the youth weekend away. Lord, we thank you for the children that have gone and the leaders. We pray you'll bring them back safely too on the roads later on this afternoon. We commit John Melville to you, Lord. We thank you that he was a big player here in the days of Lighthouse Church. So Father, we just commit him to you and pray for his measure of recovery at this point. So Lord, we pray for those on holiday, those that are being refreshed away this weekend. We commit them to you. And Lord, we just pray for a sense of your presence with us now, in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so the children can go off to Sunday school or whatever else. Thank you. Okay, thank you, Stuart.
Okay, kids, if you want to go to Sunday school, that's great. Enjoy. I was wondering if this morning if we could learn a new song for us. It's probably some of you already know it. It's called All Hail the King of Heaven. Creation, the chorus goes, All Hail the King of Heaven, creation joined together. Let endless praises crown his name. All Hail the King of Heaven. Let's stand and we'll do the chorus first and let's see how we get on. Thank you.
All hail the King of Heaven, creation joins together. Let endless praises crown his name. All hail the King of Heaven. All hail the King of Heaven, creation joins together. Let endless praises crown his name. All hail the King of Heaven.
Well done. Go for the verse.
Oh, hail the King of Heaven, Christ the Lord of all, whom thundering angels circle round the place with awe. Let now the hallelujah of earth and glad refrain ascend the throne to him belongs immortal praise. Oh, hail the King of Heaven, creation joins together. Let endless praises crown his name. Oh, hail the King of Heaven. Oh, hail the great Redeemer who so humbly came, the Lamb of our salvation, oh, for sinners slain. Let now the loud Hosanna resound from shore to shore. You nations say his kingdom reigns forever. Join together, let endless praises crown his name. Oh, hail the King of Heaven. Let praises of nation bow a symphony to sound the endless wonders of his majesty. Let every heart adore him, the great, the small, the same. The generations ever let his anthem ring. All hail the King of Heaven, creation joined together. Let endless praises crown his name. All hail the King of Heaven. All hail the King of Heaven. Creation joined together. Let endless praises crown his name. If hail the King of Heaven.
Well done. Amen. That's a great song for us to get to grips with as we go forward. The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God?
The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, and trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great, how great is our God. Age to age he stands, time is in his hand, the beginning and the end, the beginning and the end. The name above all names, He is worthy of all praise. Oh, my heart will sing, how great is our God. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God. How great is our God. Well, sing with me, how great is our God. See how great is our God.
Amen. More love, more power, more of you in my life. More love, more power, more of you in my life. And I will worship you with all of my heart. And I will worship you with all of my mind. And I will worship you with all of my strength. You are my God. Oh, you are my Lord. More love, more power, more of you in my life. More love, more power. And I will seek your face with all of my heart. And I will seek your face with all of my mind. And I will seek your face with all of my strength. For you are my Lord. You are my. More power, more of you in my life. More love, more power, more of you in my life. And I will worship you with all of my heart. And I will worship you with all of my strength. And I will worship you with all of my strength. are my God. You are my Lord. You may be seated. Thank you, Cliff.
I've titled this message From Another World, but as usually happens to me on a Saturday night, I thought that's not quite right. So I've added a subtitle, Who We Are and What We Do. And I pray that these will become clear as we go through the passage this morning. Just to recap what John spoke to us about last week, he talked about how Jesus is the cornerstone. And that is the most important stone in the building, and how it sits in the corner of the foundation, and all other stones take their direction and their position from that stone. And for us who believe in Jesus, we are now part of God's house. We are now taking our position and our direction and our identity from Jesus as God's people. And it's an incredible privilege. And I was thinking on the subject of identity. In the modern world, it's probably always been the case to some extent, but especially today, people are trying to create their identity. They're trying to self-identify. And we all do it, whether it's trying to define yourself by your sexuality, or the clothes you wear, or what you're interested in, or your success, or your failures even, or anything, we will try and find our identity in it and try and make an identity for ourselves. And the key aspect of that is we try to work it out ourselves. We try to build it ourselves. But thankfully, Peter goes through this passage and explains to us who we are in Christ, what our identity is. So have I missed a... No. I'm in the right place. Remember to number your pages better. But I'm in the right place. So Peter goes through in the passage that John went through. That's why I was confusing myself. The passage of what John went through, the last couple of verses in 1 Peter 2, verse 9 to 10. And he says, "But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy." And I highlighted there key aspects of this passage where Peter is trying to, before he gets into the details of how we should live our lives, he's trying to really nail down who we are. And I highlighted you because the truth of this message, the truth of the reality of Christ at work in our lives is too good to be true sometimes. It feels like that. And so I wanted to remind us that if you belong to Jesus this morning, if you believe in Jesus, if he has saved you and forgiven you of your sins, then this applies to you. You are part of his chosen people. You are part of his royal priesthood. You are part of his holy nation. You are his special possession. I remember struggling with a passage few years ago when it talks about God delighting in us, God delighting in me. And I thought, that can't be right. There's something wrong there. How can he delight in me, a sinner? There's something in us, our sinful hearts, that don't only resist obeying God sometimes, but they even sometimes resist God's goodness towards us, God's love towards us, God's affection. So you are God's chosen people, a royal priesthood, holy nation, and God's special possession. You are the people of God. So Peter is building or clarifying our identity in Christ before he then gets on to what we do. He emphasizes who we are. And if we come to our passage for this morning, 1 Peter 2, 11 to 17. Let's go through it. "Dear friends, I urge you as foreigners and exiles to abstain from sinful desires which wage war against your soul. Live such good lives among the pagans that though they accuse you of doing wrong, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day he visits us. Submit yourselves for the Lord's sake to every human authority, whether to the emperor as the supreme authority or to governors who are sent by him to punish those who do wrong and to commend those who do right. For it is God's will that by doing good you should silence the ignorant talk of foolish people. Live as free people, but do not use your freedom as a cover-up for evil. Live as God's slaves. Show proper respect to everyone. Love the family of believers. Fear God. Honor the emperor. So in this passage, there's so much to go through, but as we go on to the next slide, it's what we do. Peter starts clarifying in the first two verses, 11 and 12, but he also gives a little bit more information on our identity again. So, dear friends, I urge you as foreigners and exiles. So Peter is speaking to people, Jewish people at the time, predominantly, some of whom he may have known personally, who were possibly in Jerusalem before this and then were scattered through persecution. And so he knows when he's speaking to them that they are literally foreigners and exiles in the countries they're in, whether it's Turkey or Greece or wherever. But he's also going deeper than that and saying that all of us, as people who belong to Jesus, as God's people, as God's holy nation, we are foreigners and exiles in this world. We no longer fully belong to this world. There's something different about us because the Holy Spirit dwells within us. And so we are God's holy nation. We are his royal priesthood. We are his children. We are his people. But in this world, we are foreigners. And then he starts to go on to what we do after explaining who we are. We abstain from sinful desires which wage war against our souls. And I was interested when I look into this phrase, sinful desires, that there's actually a broader meaning in the Greek. When he says sinful desires, he's not talking about just your own personal sins, although that is the case. We should turn away from our sins and turn towards God. He's talking also about what the world teaches us to be, what the world considers good, but what God's word considers sinful. And if any of us don't realize that the world, through TV, through film, through music, is trying to teach us things constantly, then we need to wake up. I need to wake up to what the world is trying to teach us. I'm not a believer that thinks we need to stop watching all movies and TV shows or disengage from the modern world completely. But I think there's some things I know I need to stop watching, and there's some things I know I need to be wise with if I continue watching or listening to or reading. There's TV shows that make it normal for families to fall apart. Soap operas where people are just constantly screaming at each other and people are always cheating on their wives and husband. And although the show sometimes makes it look bad, it's normalizing it, making it look like everyday life. This is how life should be. Or there's shows that express like sexual perversion and make that sound normal, or make greed look normal. I think I mentioned months ago that I used to watch this show about people building really fancy houses and touring these mansions. And in me, over time, it built up this greed and this desire to, I want something bigger. I want a bigger house. I want more money. I want a better paid job. And that discontentment was part of my sin, but also encouraged by the world. And so Peter is talking about not just battling our own sin and turning away from our own sin, but turning away from what the world often tries to teach us, these sinful desires. And as he puts it here, they wage war against our soul. Because we're from a different world, they just do not fit with God's way of thinking and God's way of life. And they start to corrupt us and damage us. And then he goes on to say, live such good lives among the pagans that though they accuse you of doing wrong, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day he visits us. So Peter is calling us to be example citizens, something I've never considered myself, a model citizen in this world, despite being foreigners and exiles. And then in verses 13 and 17, 13 to 17, he starts to get into more details. He starts to get into more pragmatic and practical details of how we live out this identity. He says, submit yourselves for the Lord's sake to every human authority, whether to the emperor as the supreme authority or to governors who are sent by him to punish those who do wrong and to commend those who do right. For it is God's will that by doing good you should silence the ignorant talk of foolish people. Live as free people, but do not use your freedom as a cover-up for evil. Live as God's slaves. Show proper respect to everyone. Love the family of believers. Fear God. Honor the emperor. This passage, if we consider it this morning and 2,000 years ago as well, is a very shocking passage. It would have been very shocking for the people reading it at the time, many of whom had either already been persecuted or were currently experiencing persecution. To begin with, submit yourselves for the Lord's sake to every human authority is a very countercultural teaching, as I said, both today and in the past. And I summarized in the next slides the main points I wanted to look at. Submit to government authority. Both Peter and Paul teach about government authority in this sense in which, even though it was equally, if not more, corrupt at the time than it is now, there's still a sense in which the government is ordained by God, it's put in place by God, and although the people within the government are not perfect, and they're sinners, and they do things wrong, and they sometimes make terrible decisions, and they sometimes make terrible decisions deliberately, there's still in which the sense in which I cannot, as a child of God, say, well, I parked on double yellow lines, but I'm not paying my ticket because I'm from another world, or I'm a royal priest in God's kingdom. I have to live under in submission to the general authority of the government. The government has many things in place that are legitimate for justice, for a healthy society, and God is calling me to respect that and to honor it. The next point, 2 and point 3, I think, is interesting if you put them together. God is calling us to respect everyone. Show proper respect to everyone, but also to love the family of believers. There seems to be a particular emphasis on the family of believers. And if we go back to the beginning of the passage, verse 11, when it says, dear friends, I urge you, in the Greek, it's much stronger. Peter is saying, my beloved ones. Peter, again, he may have known a lot of them personally. He may have known who he was writing to. But there were also, obviously, a lot of people that will read his letter and have read his letter that he didn't know personally. And yet, because they're brothers and sisters in Christ, he is saying, my beloved ones, the ones I love. Do we generate that culture of love in our community here at Dawnside? I put these two verses here, John 13, 34 and 35, where Jesus commands his disciples, a new command I give you, he says, a new command, going above and beyond the Ten Commandments, a new command I give you, love one another as I have loved you. By this, the world will know you are my disciples, if you love one another. I sometimes find this easy, sometimes find this difficult. I think we are probably all the same. Sometimes it feels much easier to love our non-Christian family and friends than it does to love our Christian family. That's because we are under attack regularly in the church. We're under attack by the enemy, by our own sinful hearts. We debate things on scripture, sometimes legitimately, sometimes illegitimately. We get caught up in arguments and we go far too far down the line with these arguments and we end up losing love for each other as a community. So let that be a prayer for all of us here, especially as we go into our new building and God willing, we see more and more people coming along, that this would be a community where people can come out of the world for? Why would you come out of the world and come into a community where you don't feel loved? Why would you come out of the world and come into a community where you don't feel supported or safe? So love the family of believers. Then for this next one, this would have been extreme at the time. Honor the emperor. If any of you don't know, at the time Peter is writing, the emperor of Rome and the Roman Empire is Nero. Now, I didn't know a whole lot about Nero. I heard about him, but last year I read a book on Nero, and I wouldn't recommend the book because it goes into horrific detail about the kind of evil man this man was. Some people think that when it talks about the beast in Revelation, or some of you might know, that it's talking about Nero. But Nero is so evil, there's a lot of things he did that I wouldn't even want to say out loud. But to summarize it, he sexually abused children, his wife. He was violent. He was perverse in multiple ways. And he was a liar. He killed a lot of Christians and lied about what they had done and basically framed people. There was a whole long list of how evil this man is. And yet God's word tells us, honor the emperor. And in our day, of course, honor the king, honor the prime minister, honor the first minister, honor the president. But how can this be? How can you honor someone that is so sinful, so evil? Well, there's a great scene in one of my favorite TV shows. I watch a lot of TV shows. But it's called Band of Brothers. I don't know if any of you have seen it, but it's a great show about this troop of American soldiers that went all the way from the beaches in Normandy to Hitler's hideout, basically, in Austria, all the way. It's a great show, isn't it? And there's a scene in I think it's the first episode, where these two soldiers, one is a higher rank than the other, and they don't like each other. And they're having to, the higher ranked soldier is ordering the soldiers to get in line, and they have to salute him. But this lower-ranked soldier doesn't like him. I can't remember exactly why, but they've got a bad relationship. And so initially he refuses to salute. But the higher-ranked soldier, I think he's a general maybe, he says, you salute the rank, you don't salute the person. And this is kind of what it's like for us as Christians to honor the emperor. Honor the king, honor the prime minister. I have a lot to say about Boris Johnson, Nicola Sturgeon, Joe Biden. The list goes on both sides. The politicians can very easily be criticized. But I'm not honoring them because of their perfect characters. I'm not honoring them because they are worthy of it. It's because they have a position that God has ordained that we should honor. If the Christians at the time of Nero, one of the most evil men in history, have to honor him, then I can honor Boris Johnson. I can honor Rishi Sunak. I can honor Nicola Sturgeon. And the honor is simply respecting the authority they have in as far as they don't go against God's word and God's authority. And the final point was to fear God. And in a sense, this summarizes, enables us to do all of these. If we recognize that God is the ultimate authority, that our lives are in his hands, even for those of us who are saved, have you ever considered, although God will never go against his word, have you ever considered, my life is in his hands, my salvation is in his hands, my eternal life is in his hands? It's like being in awe of a creature vastly beyond you, and you just are so small. We are just so small. And so there is a sense in which it's not a terror, because we know the Lord, we love him, we know he loves us, and he has our best interests at heart. But there is a sense in which it's not just respect. It's not just simple respect for God. There's a sense of awe that is almost like fear. And when we put that in perspective, then honoring an evil king, honoring a corrupt government, all becomes easier, and all flows from that identity we have as a child of God, as a person in God's kingdom that honors him first. So this is who we are, and this is what we do. And I thought briefly just to mention a time, is there ever a time to rebel? I think in a lot of ways this is not an easy question, but you can give a simple answer as yes. We see it today even in our country. There are teachers and doctors and workers of various sorts and people even in the government that have had to peacefully and respectfully and lovingly say, I can't go along with this. I can't agree with this. You are asking me to do something that is contrary to the truth, to God's truth, to reality, and I just cannot go along with it. And that's in our country. And in other countries where it is much more extreme, there are many Christians, brothers and sisters, that lovingly and peacefully often rebel against a corrupt authority that is going against God's word. But as far as the emperor and the government are in keeping with God's justice and God's word, we must submit to their authority and not rebel. So who we are is God's special possession, his holy nation, his people. And what we do is, in this passage this morning, Peter is outlining how to react against the government, to submit to the government authority, to respect everyone, to love the family of believers, to honor the emperor, and to fear God. And one thing I wanted to finish with is a reminder that these are all things that if we fall out of our drift in our relationship with God, or if we're not relying on the power of the Holy Spirit, then they are impossible for us to do. They are very difficult for us to do, but the difficult part, the most difficult part, has already been given to us, the identity. We could not generate our own identity. We couldn't work for our identity. We, most of us here, know what it's like when we fail at trying to create our own identity. But Jesus has already lived this perfect life in our place, given us a new identity as his special possession, as his holy nation, as his royal priesthood. And he simply calls us by his strength, by his wisdom, by the truth of his word, to live it out. When we come up against challenges in terms of government authority, local authority, the family of believers, struggling to respect people, definitely struggling to respect or honor the emperor, or even when we lose that fear of God in our lives, Jesus is there by his Holy Spirit to help us walk in these ways that are so countercultural. It's so normal. I've done it many times this week, even just with colleagues at work, to just slip into dishonoring speech about the government, mocking politicians, not respecting people. But when we are faced with these things, when we are reminded of our sin in these areas, Jesus is there to walk with us and enable us to live out our new identity. So praise God for that. Let's pray as we finish. Father, I thank you for doing all for us, for finishing your task on the cross, for paying the debt of our sin, wiping our slate clear, clothing us in your righteousness, and giving us new identities, identities that are just way beyond what we could have imagined. Lord, the identities that we try to build in this life are so small. Even if we achieve them, they're so small in comparison to being a holy nation, God's chosen people, your special possession, something you and someone you delight in, and your royal priesthood, and a child of God. You offer that to us freely, Lord. And then from that identity, we can go and live the way in which you ask us to live. We pray that you would empower us, Lord, as a church here, to submit to government authority as far as they are under your truth, to respect everyone, even our enemies, and to love even our enemies as our Lord taught us to, and to love each other in particular, the body of Christ, our brothers and sisters in Christ, that we would grow in a love for each other, a practical and action-based love, Lord. We pray, Father, that you would help us to honor our politicians and to do that ultimately by praying for our politicians, praying for our governments, our local councils, Lord. Praying that they would use the tax money well to fund and sustain our city and our region and our country. Pray that our leaders would turn to you for wisdom, for guidance, that they would humble themselves and stop making their own rules on the spot. I pray, Lord, that you would instill in us this desire to see life transformation in our government leaders and political leaders. And that, Lord, you would be honored among the leaders of the world and glorified. We pray that you would help us, Lord, to grow in our reverent fear of you and our love for you, and that would mold every aspect of our lives and that would help us to walk in a right order of recognizing our identity in you. We pray these things, Lord, and pray you bless us this morning as we sing your worship and also as we fellowship together with teas and coffees. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you. Thank you, Cliff. Our final song focuses on the last line of Cliff's last slide, and that is the fear of God. And having a respect and having a love and having a desire to please him, to worship him, to acknowledge him as our creator and savior is our full-time job. All the other lists, these things you saw in Cliff's list, you think, don't need to worry about them. I don't get too involved in politics, or I don't get too involved in the hierarchy of social life. But it's our conduct, isn't it? With fellow friends and family, how we behave in front of them. That's where the monitoring, and that's where that applies. But the last one is the most important one, the fear of God. And I think once we grasp that in our lives, I think we can see the benefits spiritually of us changing to be more like Christ, and that's what we're aiming for. So the song is, I am thine, O Lord. I have heard thy voice and told it, thy love to me. Let's stand and sing. Consecrate me now to thy service, Lord, by the power of grace divine. Let my soul look up with a steadfast hope, and my will be lost in thy. Oh, draw me near. Blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. precious bleeding son. Oh, the pure delight of a single hour that before thy throne I spend. When I kneel in prayer and with thee, my God, I commune as friend with friend. Oh, draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding Son. There are depths of love that I cannot know till I cross the narrow sea. There are heights of joy that I may not reach till I rest in peace with thee. Oh, draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding Son. That is our prayer, Lord, today. Draw us nearer to yourself, Lord, and we will draw near to you. We think of your cross. They drew near to us. We think of your bleeding side, how it was poured out for us. And we thank you from the depths of our hearts, Lord, and we want to worship you in spirit and in truth, Lord. Bless us as we have fellowship together over tea and coffee, Lord. May our conversation be about you and be wholesome. Lord, may we have a blessed time together. Also, Lord, when we leave here, please be with us, Lord. Protect our families and especially our children. Wrap a hedge of protection around each one of them. We pray in your name, Jesus. We thank you for your presence today, Lord, and we worship you.